Okay, so let's get started. So real quick, the announcement for Project 3, I will send out an email either today or tomorrow about how you guys should be pull the latest changes from our master branch, because we have a bunch of fixes that are relevant, for, I think, for a lot of you guys. So in particular, we have the new Postgres parser in place. So you shouldn't be, you know, the old one, which was broken, is gone. We now take Postgres and convert it into our own objects. We hope to have a new catalog for you guys within a couple days. And there's a bunch of other bug fixes that we found that we've been fixing the last 2 weeks. So I'll send an email how to do this. Essentially, you want to do a rebase, not a pull, and that way any changes you've made get put to the top of the to the commit log. And then if you ever need to roll back to an earlier version, it's easier that way. And that way it's not all intermingled with your changes with our changes. Okay? All right, so for today's lecture, I think this is probably what I consider one of the most important topics of the semester, because as we'll see in a second, the performance gains you can get from doing query compilation or code specialization is actually quite significant. And I would argue that every database system that comes out in the next, you know, from this point going forward, if you're not doing query compilation, then you're just not going to be able to compete with the other systems that are out there, because the performance gains you can get from doing this is a lot. So we'll start off talking about the background of what code specialization or query compilation looks like, and then we'll look at two techniques for doing this. So the first is called code generation or transpilation, and this is basically having source code that generates more source code, and then you compile it. And then we'll talk about how to do this JIT compilation that was in the Hyper paper that you guys read using the LLVM. And it is my opinion that this is the better way to do it, and this is what we're actually pursuing in our own system today. And there's not very many systems that do this. As we'll see at the very end, when we talk about the real world implementations, it's only maybe, I think, 5 in the world. So, and then we'll talk about what it takes to actually do this. All right, so there's this, the reason why this compilation stuff or code specialization stuff is important is because when we start looking at what it's gonna take to make our system run faster, we're getting to the point where we're running out of options. Right, we already said that we were going to get rid of disk, we're going to have an in-memory database system, but now if everything's in memory, how are we going to get our system to run even faster, to support more complex applications, more complex queries, and larger data sets? So there's this great calculation, or this sort of back-of-the-envelope calculation that the Microsoft guys did in a hackathon paper when they were sort of designing their system to figure out how can they get this thing to, you know, run as fast as possible. And again, the original motivation of Hackathon was they were looking to build a new in-memory database engine. In this case, it was for OLTP, but they were, you know, looking at having to be support to run much faster than what the current SQL Server system could do. So when Hackathon got started, SQL Server was already 25 years old. And they were looking to say, well, what do we need to do to get us to, you know, have the system be around for the next 25 years and still remain competitive? And so what they found is that because everything's already in memory, then you're not paying any more disk penalty. The only way that you're going to really get better throughput and better performance is simply just by doing less work, meaning executing less instructions to execute the same queries that you had before. And so they sort of had this rough calculation that says, if you want the data system to go fast, 10x faster, then you need to execute 90% fewer instructions than what you have in your original system. But to get to 100x faster, you need to execute 99% fewer instructions, right? That's a lot, right? So there's not gonna be this magic flag we can give to GCC, like, oh, you know, 100, that's gonna make these instructions go away. We have to be smarter about how we design our system, and code specialization is the way we're gonna do this. I will say also that another metric you could use to determine whether you're speeding your system up is not just the number of instructions, but also the instructions per cycle. And the idea there is that, again, this sort of takes into consideration cache misses and things like that, memory stalls, so that you try to avoid those things so you can just have the system being running at full capacity or full utilization. So the only way that we're gonna get the kind of reduction that we just talked about here is through code specialization. And the idea of code specialization is that rather than having this sort of general purpose framework or execution engine in our database system that can run on any possible query plan that the optimizer gives it. We're going to instead create code that is only designed or will only execute the thing that it's supposed to execute. So again, we'll see a bunch of examples of what I mean by this. But like, instead of seeing a query plan where you have to look at it and say, well, what's my predicate I want to evaluate? What attributes are my tuples I want to touch? What type do they have? Instead of having these like giant switch statements decide, oh, is my data this type versus that type, I'm just going to bake in exactly into machine code. I know it's this type and it's this predicate on this data, and you just execute that. There's no if clauses. There's no virtual function table lookups. You just execute just the bare minimum you need to compute whatever it is that you want to compute. So this is the main idea for code specialization. And you may think, all right, well, this sort of seems obvious. Why doesn't everybody do this? Well, it turns out, as I see it was to go along in the lecture, part of the reason why existing systems don't do this for the most part is that the code you're going to end up writing for doing code specialization is a lot harder to debug and a lot harder for humans to understand. And actually, the slowest way to write your query execution engine or operate on queries is actually the easiest for us as humans to understand. So most of the time, and again, we did this in our own system, we're guilty of this, when you build the first version of your system, you build code that is easy for you to engineer, but as I'll show in the next example, it's actually the worst thing for performance. So in this example, I'm going to use three tables, A, B, and C. A and B have a primary key and then a value attribute, and then C just has foreign key references on both A and B. So the example we're going to use is this query here, which is a three-way join between A, B, and C. And this actually comes from the paper you guys read from the Hyper guys. And what it's doing is it's going to do a nested or subquery on B to compute some kind of aggregate. And then in the outer query, you'll do a join on A and B with C. And so we didn't really discuss this in this class, but typically the way you rewrite nested queries in your optimizer is you just rewrite it as a join, right? So to do this nested query is essentially a join on B and C with A. Another way is you could extract this query out and execute it first and put it into a temp table and then do another join on that temp table in the original query. But for our purposes, it doesn't matter. All right, so in this case here, I'm showing how to do this sort of one single query using joins. So this is sort of the relational algebra plan or the logical plan to execute this query. For everything we're talking about in this class, we don't care about the physical plan because we're not talking about how you actually implement the different algorithms to do joins and other things. We can use all the same techniques that we talked about before. So we only need to deal with this discussion at a logical level. So the way this would actually be implemented in a system, in sort of a volcano iterator style system that we would teach in an intro class, is that for all these operators, there's essentially these for loops that are going to iterate over it's the input tuples for the operator, and then emit them to the next guy up in the tree. So again, the volcano iterator model, the way it works is you start at the top, and you literally just start executing this code, right? So in the first code, the first line you have call left got get next. So it's going to call get next on its left child to go get some tuple that it needs before it can do any processing. So this is a function call down in here, and this says, all right, when I start executing this, I have a single child, and I'll call get next on that, and that's the iterator or the scan on A. And then this thing just takes the tuples, shoves it up to A, or to this filter. The filter evaluates the predicate, and if it matches, then we pass it up to here. And again, from as a human, this is sort of easy to understand because it's sort of these, you're traversing this tree, you're calling get next, and all your children operators, and you're just sort of passing tuples up in the plan. And then once you have enough, data, whatever you need, you can then maybe also shove it up to your operator. So again, normally when I always tell my students when they give a presentation, like never show code because people's eyes sort of glaze over when they see a bunch of code. But for this lecture, we kind of have to, right? Because to talk about code generation, you kind of need to show code. So it turns out this approach here is pretty much every data system you can think of, this is pretty much how they implement it. MySQL, Oracle, DB2, Postgres, all right, this is essentially what they do. We'll talk about more about this on Thursday, we talked a little about this before, about like systems like VectorWise or Narrensis and Peloton, we don't pass around single tuples, we pass around sort of blocks of tuples or vectors. But for the most part, it's always sort of starting at the top and going down the bottom and pulling things up. So the reason why this is actually the worst for your CPU is because you have sort of no locality of these tuples, right? You essentially are making a function call here, and that would then be a branching operation in the actual instructions. And so if the system predicts incorrectly, it'll flush your address or instruction cache or instruction pipeline and fill it back up when it moves to the next thing. And then all of these, again, are just function calls where we're jumping to some new location of memory and you know allocating space on the stack and moving things around, right? So this is bad, right? So having to do all these function calls, having to pass around a single tuple, one at a time, is bad for locality because, you know, as this thing evaluates the predicate and it may emit it, we end up may not doing any more work with it until we get back up to here, right? So at a high level, executing the query plan with the Volcano model is bad for modern CPUs. The other problem we're going to have also too is how we're going to evaluate the predicates. Right? So in this case here, we'll just look at this one example here. So this is taking b.value equals some input parameter, because this is a prepared statement, plus one, some constant. So the way a traditional database system would represent this predicate is through a syntax tree like this. Right? So you sort of have at the top, you have the equality predicate, and it's going to have left and right children. Right? On the left side, it says, give me the value for the current tuple I'm looking at. Give me the value of the val attribute for the current tuple I'm looking at. And on this side, it wants to do an addition for this operator here and that operator there. So you're essentially going to have to evaluate the predicate by traversing this tree for every single tuple you process as you scan a table. And so the way to make this work is that when we invoke the evaluation function on this tree, we also have to pass in some execution context information that says, what tuple are we currently looking at? What were the input parameters that were passed in to the prepared statement by the application? As well as what's the schema of the table we're looking at, so that if we want to look up an attribute, we know where to go, you know, find the offset that has the thing that we're looking for. So again, for every single tuple, we're going to start at the root of the tree, go down on this side here, and this says, again, I want this attribute called val, give me the current value. So then I'll have to go look up in my current tuple at some offset as defined in the table schema. So as I make a function call down in here, I then may have to do another function call lookup to say, well, how do I get to this offset and what should the type be? All just produce the one value that I need. And then I traverse back up the equality, and then go down on the right side, and same thing. I'll jump to this piece here, or this operator, and it says, give me the parameter at position 0, so I look at my context information to get that. And then in this case here, it's a constant 1, so it always puts out 1, right? That's easy. But then we pass these up the tree, we produce a summation here, and then we finally do our evaluation of the two sides to see whether this evaluates to true. So again, we're doing this traversal in this tree for every single tuple that we have to look at. Right? You can be smart about certain things, like if I know there's like maybe an and conjunction and one side evaluates to false, I know I don't need to go down the other side. But in general, you always have to go through and look at everything. So in this case here, to evaluate one tuple, I have to do 4 function lookups at least, you know, depending on how I represent this context information. For every single tuple, I'm doing 4 function lookups just to evaluate this one predicate, right? And so this is another reason why this is very expensive to do, right? So not only do we have to pay all these function pointer costs as we evaluate the entire plan going down, because all these emits and all these get next are function calls. Then for every single tuple, then we have to do all these function calls in here to evaluate the predicates. So this is the problem that code specialization is trying to solve, right? So rather than having this sort of generalized execution engine to do the evaluation of predicates, to evaluate the queries, we want to sort of bake into like native machine code just to perform exactly the function, the evaluation or whatever it is the data system needs to do just for that one query. And we don't have to do any switch statement lookups to say, what kind of type am I looking at? What kind of operator do I have in my expression tree? We don't have to say anything about like jump. And the data I'm looking for is at this offset, and it's at this type, and cast it that way before I pass it along to the next operator. Everything we can know ahead of time, because we know what the query is going to do, because it's a declarative language like SQL, so we know exactly what data it wants to touch. We know what it wants to do with that data, and we know what kind of answer we need to produce. So we can know all of this a priori, and then we can have code that's specialized to execute the thing that we want to do without worrying about any conditionals. So we can do code specialization for access methods, right? So doing sequential scan, as I showed before, we know how to jump to the different offsets that we need to get the data we want. We know what type it's going to be. We won't talk about this too much in this lecture, but in some systems, you can actually do compilation of stored procedures. So instead of interpreting PLPG SQL, you can just generate machine code that can execute that stuff directly. We can do operator execution, and that's, again, doing the joins and other things. I showed how to do a predicate evaluation. And then the last one here, logging operations, I don't think anybody actually does this, and this is something that we're interested in pursuing here at CMU. The way to think about all these things is anytime you have to make a decision about, you know, do I go down one code path in my if statement or switch statement, if it's this type versus that type, or if I have to parse anything, then code specialization can make a big difference. If you know exactly what the data is going to look like, then you don't have to worry about making runtime decisions. You bake everything ahead of time and then sort of set it and forget it. Right? So this is the core idea that, you know, of code specialization. And this is what we're going to focus on doing this in the context of query compilation. All right, so I sort of alluded to all these things before. Right? The benefits we get out of this is that we don't have to do any function calls just, you know, based on what type we're looking at. We'll know everything ahead of time, and we can convert everything to inline execution. We know what all the predicates are going to be, and so that means that we don't have to traverse that tree anymore. We can just write the machine code to do exactly, in the previous example, you know, this offset, you know, check if this offset equals this plus one, right? And then in our loops, we can try to avoid having function calls, and this is going to allow us in the paper that you guys read from Piper. Is that you're going to be able to keep tuples in CPU registers, which is the fastest memory you can have, and go through the pipeline and execute everything really, really fast without ever having to write anything out to CPU caches or even out to memory. All right, so just to ground everyone, what we're talking about here, so this is the same pipeline that I showed a few weeks ago when we talked about query optimization and query planning, all right? And the piece that I'm adding is right here. The compiler. Right? This is after the query plan comes out of the optimizer. We then want to convert it into either LLVM IR or C++ code or C code, depending on how we're doing our code generation compilation scheme. Right? So we take the physical plan from the optimizer, feed it into the compiler, and the compiler then generates native code, a native machine code that we can execute directly inside of our system. Right? So it's the same. So it's the same plan that we talked about before. It's just now we're going to convert it into something that's much faster, and we're no longer going to interpret the plan. We just execute it directly. All right. So there's essentially two ways to do code generation. The first approach is what's called transpilation. It's also called source-to-source compilation. And the idea here is that we're going to have code in our database system that knows how to take our query plan that the optimizer generates, and then it'll convert that into like C or C++ code, and then we take that C++ code and then run it through our favorite compiler, and that generates native code. Like, you know, you run it through GCC and it spits out native code, and then we link in that shared object, and then we invoke some function on our shared object. So that's one way to do it, and we'll discuss that first. And then the approach that you guys read in the Hyper paper is to do JIT compilation. And this is where, instead of generating C++ code, we can generate some intermediate representation called an IR that we can then efficiently compile into native code using something like LLVM. Right, you can also do this in Java. You can generate bytecode and feed that into the JVM and have that execute it. If you're using in Windows, you could generate bytecode for the CLR. Right, it's the same idea. So we'll go through both of these one by one. We'll discuss the different trade-offs of each of these. So one of the optional papers you guys didn't read that was listed on the website was this prototype system called Haiku. And so Haiku was doing the transpilation stuff. It was doing the source-to-source compilation, where, again, they give in a query plan, they generate C++ code, and in that C++ code, since, again, they know what the data you're trying to access, they know what type it has, they just, again, bake that in all into the execution code. And then they link that in, and then when you invoke the query, you just invoke the run function on that shared object, the thing that you generate, and then it can then produce the same kind of answer you would have. It would produce the same kind of answer in the same format that your interpreter engine would have as well. Right. So again, for this, it is using off-the-shelf compiler. They're using GCC. And again, from the upper levels of the system, it doesn't know that it's using code-generated execution engine. It just knows it gets tuples back in the same format that it expects. So just go sort of through what this looks like. All right, say we have a basic query here. Select star from A, where A.val equals some input parameter plus one. Right. So the interpreted plan, so the example that I showed with Volcano before would look like this, right? You just do a range scan over the table for some number of tuples, and then for every tuple you get back from the table, you evaluate this predicate, and then if it evaluates to true, then you just emit it to the next operator in the tree. And so all the things we're going to try to avoid are in our C++ generated code is that in the case of getting the tuple, we don't want to worry about having to do a lookup in the catalog to figure out what the type is. We don't have to do a lookup to say, you know, where do I find the different attributes that I need for this tuple. And we don't have to even worry about getting a pointer to the tuple. If everything's in memory, then all we have to do is now basic arithmetic to say, I'm at this offset in the table. I know the size of the tuple that I'm looking at because they're all fixed size in the fixed size pool or the heap for the table. So I just know how to jump exactly to that, get the tuple that I want. And then the other problem also too, we avoid when we have the predicate, we don't want to traverse that tree like I showed before, and we don't do any work about looking into the execution context to decide where's the parameter that I need to fill in that value, and I don't need to cast anything to the appropriate type. All right, so the templated plan or the C++ plan that we would generate essentially looks like this. So at a high level, it's doing the exact same thing, right? It's just scanning over the tuples and emitting any tuple that matches. But the key difference here is that we have sort of these constants that we can pre-compute ahead of time based on what table we're accessing, and that we then fill in to do any kind of calculation or arithmetic to find the tuple that we're looking for in the templated plan. Right? So in the case of before, when we said get tuple, we had to know how to jump to the right offset based on the size of the tuple. We don't need to do that anymore. Now we just multiply the address by the starting address of the table by what offset we're looking at by the size of the tuple, and that jumps us to the right location. For this, I'm assuming we're using the row store or NRE or NSM storage format, but the basic idea applies the same in a column store, right? And then the same thing for evaluating the predicates. We know what offset we're looking at in our input sequence or input parameters for the prepared statement. So we just jump to that location to get what we want. And then we just evaluate it to produce the value that we're looking for. So again, we don't have to evaluate any function that traverses the tree. In this case here, this code, does value equal some parameter? That's exactly how it was written in the where clause of the query. So we don't have to do any additional lookups to see whether this values are true. It's literally just the one instruction to say, does this value in this register equal that value in that register? And that's really, really fast. No longer we do function lookups. No longer do we have to pass around results of different operators in our expression tree. It's just one instruction and it produces the output. All right, so this is why this is gonna be really, really fast, because we're just avoiding all this extra work we would have to have in a general purpose system. Okay, so one important thing to point out about this is that in our, you have a question? Yes?
In the previous slide, when you simplify the if statement, does it also help in the branch prediction and order for the execution? Like you have a much simpler statement, also you're not doing a function lookup.
So his question is, in the sort of the compiled version of the query plan, because I no longer have these extra function lookups, Does that help with
branch prediction?
Correct, yes. Yes, you don't have any more, you're less likely to have branch misprediction because.
So you will get faster because you're doing better predictions for the branch also.
Yes, we'll talk about more about this on Thursday, the branch misprediction stuff, because you still have an if clause here. Yes. Right? You can't avoid that and how it's written in here. There's other ways to avoid that. We'll talk about that on Thursday. But yeah, no longer in here. The predicate one's probably the easiest one to understand because, like, that's like you're traversing this tree, right? And it may be the case that, like, if you have a conjunction, it may be the case that you don't have to go down one side of the tree based on what the other side actually produced. But, like, the CPU is probably not going to be able to figure that out because it's going to be different for every single tuple. So, yeah, so absolutely you're going to have fewer branch mispredictions because sort of everything's sort of in line together. There's fewer if clauses. Right. Also, too, when you do a function lookup, right? If you're using C++, if you have all this sort of, if you have inheritance in your objects, you have to do a lookup on the virtual function table to say what's the actual function I want to look up. So there's actually two lookups to do a function, right? And so we can avoid all that here. All right. So one important thing to point out about this code generation stuff is that it's still going to be able to invoke the other parts of the system that aren't using code specialization. So in our case, in Peloton, right, we have our indexes written in C++, we have our concurrent control manager written in C++. We don't want to have to rewrite all that into like LLVM. And you don't want to sort of have to rewrite all that and bake it into our query plan. So it's sort of obvious in this case with Haiku because you can just, you're generating C++ code. And of course, it can invoke other C++ code. But in the case of the LLMIR, you saw this in the Hyper paper, you still can invoke the other parts of the system that may be written in C++. And so the benefit of this is that for those parts of the system, it's unlikely that code specialization is going to provide you with really any benefit. So rather than writing in sort of a more arcane language that's harder to debug, you can then have your generated code invoke the regular code that you still have written in your regular language. And that makes it easier to debug, makes it easier from a software engineering standpoint. So again, so in the same way that when you have interpreted queries, the interpreted queries would invoke the transaction manager or the log manager and all these other things, your templated code, your generated code can do the same thing. But you can still interact natively with the other parts of the system without having to rewrite everything. And that's often overlooked, and I think that's a really important aspect of this. It makes it easier from an engineering standpoint. All right, so in the Haiku paper, they want to evaluate to see how this actually performs. And what I like about this paper is they actually implemented all the different variations of how you could do sort of translation or code generation in their system. Going from what we have where everything's interpreted, which they call the generic iterators, to their sort of auto-generated query-specific code that they're going to run using GCC. But then they're also going to have code that's were sort of handwritten by an expert, and they want to see how well this performs versus the sort of auto-generated code. Because ideally, you want this to be very close to this, right? All right, so this paper is from 2009, so this is running on a much older CPU than we're used to, but the high-level ideas are essentially the same. And so in this graph, I'm showing they're measuring the time spent doing L2 cache misses, memory stalls, and actually invoking executing instructions. They also measure L1 cache misses, but because those are so short and so small that they don't even really show up, so I didn't include them, but they're in the original paper. So again, this as expected, the sort of the interpreted engine is always going to perform the worst. Right, and then as you sort of get closer and closer to, in this case, at this point here, the super optimized or the truly optimized versions of the query plans, you see these guys are performing the best. So this is showing that if you add a little bit more code specialization, you get closer and closer, but it's only if you do the full code specialization for the entire query plan do you get the best performance. And they're showing that in their case, the Haiku, their auto-generated code is actually just a little bit faster than the optimized hard-coded stuff. And this is because their compiler they've written the code in such a way that the compiler can find additional optimizations that the hard-coded one wasn't able to utilize. Right. So again, another thing here is see that you don't have any memory stalls for these guys over here is because you don't have any branch misprediction. You don't have any you're having less function lookups or function invocations. So you're allocating less things on the stack. Everything's sort of in line very nicely. It's a very tight kernel. So this is a great paper that shows the benefit you can get from doing code specialization. So what's one obvious problem with doing this translation or source-to-source compilation?
Compiling C code is slow.
Yeah, he says compiling C code is slow. Absolutely, yes. So they also measured the time it takes to actually compile the query. So this is just running the query. This assumes after you've already run it, it's already been compiled. But then they also measured what it takes to actually compile these queries. So for this, they're comparing running GCC with O0, meaning no optimizations, with O2. Now, they didn't do O3, which is normally what people use when you ship production software. And O3 is much more aggressive than O2. It does a lot more things, so it's definitely going to take much longer. But what you see in the case of O1, this is like the bare minimum you can get, you know, with GCC without any optimizations. This is around 150 milliseconds, all the way up to over 200 milliseconds, right? Now, if you turn on the optimizations, now and for this last query Q3, now you're over 600 milliseconds. That's a lot, right? So before, in this example here, I don't forget what query this was, but like, this was sort of the micro benchmark. But like, their query could run in roughly 50 milliseconds, but if you turn on compilation, the compilation takes 600 milliseconds. So all the benefit you get from doing query compilation is thrown out the window because you take so much to actually compile these queries. For OLTP, this won't really be a big an issue because everything's going to be executed as prepared statements, and everything will be it'll be the same queries you see over and over again. So like the first query would take a long time, but everything if you cache that, everything will run faster. And this is actually what MemSQL originally did, and I'll talk about that at the end. But for an OLAP query, a one-off query, if someone's typing in the terminal, and the query takes six times as long as it should because you're compiling, then that's not a good trade-off, right? So again, the LLVM stuff will solve this a little bit, but it actually it isn't magic. It isn't perfect, right? All right, so the main takeaways that to get from the Haiku stuff is that the doing compilation with GCC is expensive, relative to the time it takes to execute its query, and they were sort of solving the problem of having to do the function lookups to evaluate predicates and get tuples from the table. But it still was sort of following the basic iterator model, the volcano model, for pulling up tuples from the bottom of the query plan and then pulling them to the top. So you're still calling get next, get next, get next, all the way down the tree to go move tuples up. All right? Again, this is real quick. Part of the reason why GCC is so slow is when you think about what it's actually doing. So they're actually, when the query comes in, they fork the GCC process, pass in the source code that they generate from the query plan, and then GCC allocates memory, compiles it, and then writes it out to a shared object, and then link that into the system. Right? So when GCC starts up, it's looking at config files, it's looking at command line parameters, it's looking at environment stuff. Right? There's a lot of extra overhead just to fork GCC just to do this compilation. So that's part of the reason why this is going to be so slow. Right? So the two problems with Haiku are GCC slow, and then they are not doing full pipelining. All right, so a pipeline is is where we can have in our query plan, in our tree, we can have a tuple move as far as up into the tree as possible without ever doing a context switch to switch and look at another tuple. All right, and this is going to allow you to have better cache locality, maybe also be able to keep the tuple actually in CPU registers and move it from one operator to the next. The idea is that you bring a tuple into your CPU registers and you do as much processing as you can on it before you have to move on to another tuple or another operator. And that's going to allow you to reduce the number of instructions you have to do because you're reducing the number of cache. Actually, it's still the same number of instructions, but you reduce the number of cycles because you're not going to have any cache misses. So we go back to the same plan that we had before. So in this query plan, the pipeline boundaries are defined into these four areas here. And again, a pipeline is where we can take a single tuple and we can do all the processing that we need on it before we have to then block into the next operator to get more data or get more tuples. So the simplest one to look at is here. So if I'm doing a scan on B, I can scan the tuples on B, evaluate the predicate that I need to evaluate, but in this point here, when I actually want to compute the aggregation on or using the group by, I can't compute the count of number of tuples per group until I get all the tuples in. So this is called the pipeline breaker, right? Because this is where the pipeline has to stop, because in order to go to the next pipeline, I have to get all the tuples from the pipeline below me. The same thing for this, right? This is on the build side of the join. So I can do my scan on A, and I can do all my filtering, but then as I build my hash table, I can't actually do anything, can't do my join, because I still have to wait for the other tuples from the other pipeline to come in. Right, so again, the idea of a pipeline, we're going to see this in Hyper, is that they want to do as much as possible within a pipeline for a single tuple before switching to the next tuple or the next operator. And then keep everything in localized in your caches. So the way Hyper is going to do this is using LLVM to do query compilation. Right? And so there's actually two major things I want you to get out of this paper. One was they're using LLVM instead of C++. And the second is that they're going to do this push-based query execution or query model, query processing model, instead of the pool-based model that we saw in Haiku and sort of traditional, you know, volcano-style database systems. So with the LLVM, if you're not familiar with the LLVM, it's it originally started off as a new compiler to replace Clang and GCC out of UIUC. And then what they ended up sort of evolving into this sort of collection of different compiler technologies and components that you could then build together to make sort of more complicated things. So the LLVM, like the low-level virtual machine piece, is sort of one component of this all this other stuff that the LLVM project works on. And so the core thing that we care about is going to generate this low-level programming language called IR, the intermediate representation, that is going to look a lot like assembly language, but it's going to be not specific to any CPU architecture. Right? So meaning, like, if you wrote assembly for x86, it may not run on Spark machines, but if you wrote sort of assembly using the IR, the LLVM would be able to compile it to run on whatever hardware or ISA that you want it to run on. Right? And again, we talked about this before, not all the components in our database system are happy written in the LLVM IR, because we're still going to be able to make calls out to C++ to the other parts of the system without having to rewrite them. Those won't get the speed up benefit you would get with LLVM, but it makes it easier from a software engineering standpoint that we can still reuse other code. So first of all, so Hyper is going to do LLVM, and then they're also going to use this push-based execution model. So what I'll say is, though, these aren't conjoined. Like, you can have the push-based model without using LLVM, and you can use LLVM without using the push-based model. The paper is combining two really good ideas into a single one research paper. So this is the same query plan that we saw before, but now we're going to annotate the different for loops in our generated code based on the pipelines that I showed before in this model. So the first pipeline here, pipeline one, it's going to iterate over A, and then it's going to do the evaluation of the attribute to see whether it matches our predicate. And then if it does, then we'll add it to the hash table that we're going to use for the join later on. Right? And then once this is done, then we can then transition to pipeline two, where we can then spin through on B and do the same kind of thing. And now, for this, since we need to compute the count on B, we can write it into a hash table. Once this is all done, the hash table is complete, then we can compute the count, and then spit that data out into the next pipeline, which then will compute the join on first feed into C, or C will feed into the first join, use pipeline three to compute that, and then use that output then and produce in the final join up at the top here. So I'm walking through this as if it was running as a single thread, but this is the same system from this is the same project that was in the Morsels paper that you guys read. So there's no reason that different CPUs, different cores, different threads could be operating on these different pipelines at the same time. It doesn't have to be, everyone doesn't have to always do the first one, then switch over to the next one. You can, if you want in your scheduler, you could decide how to, you know, spread out these different tasks and run at different times based on the locality of where the data is that you're processing. Yes?
Doesn't this model though require some sort of physical plan knowledge? With the joins, you're determining like which side of the joint is going to be blocking is dependent on the physical plan.
Yeah, so his question is, doesn't what I'm describing here depend on the physical plan? Absolutely, yes. So, you know, when I said like we don't care about the physical plan, I mean that like in the discussion of this material, I don't need to tell you that it's a hash join versus a sort merge join. But absolutely, like you need to know what's what to actually produce the code, right? This is, you know, I'm being vague here. Materialize T into hash table. Like, it's, you know, I'm saying in English what it's actually doing, but you're absolutely right. You would take the physical plan and then bake into the LLM-IR what exactly it is, the equivalent, you know, machine code to do that. Yeah, that's a good point. Okay. So the give an idea what, you know, what performance benefit you can get from this. So they actually, the papers are nice because they, in the original version of Hyper, they actually did it the way that Haiku did it, and the way MemSQL used to do it, where you would do translation, you would generate C++ code. So we actually have an apples comparison of a system doing the LLVM and the same system also doing C++ code gen. And we can see what the performance difference we have. So the first thing I point out is this is running, this the y-axis is on log scale. And for the comparison, they're going to be using hyper LLVM, hyper C++, vector-wise, MonadB, and then the unnamed one was, or DBX was just Oracle. So Oracle MonadB will be doing, actually take it back. Oracle would definitely be doing interpretation, so it's not a surprise that it's slower across the board. MonadB does, it does co-specialization for just the predicates, but it doesn't do any code specialization for the scans and the other things. We'll talk about VectorWise at the end. VectorWise actually does something quite different. They actually do code specialization by pre-generating all different possible types of primitives or, that you could execute on a query or execute on a table. Meaning, and I'll show examples of this, like they'll pre-generate all the functions to take, you know, value equals some parameter, and they'll generate one for ints and floats and whatever other types you have. So they'll generate 5,000 of these different primitives, and they need to know how to stitch them together at runtime. So you're essentially sort of doing the same thing as the LLVM stuff, the C++ stuff, but you're not generating on the fly. You pre-compute everything when you start the system, or when the system is created. So this is showing across the board, the LLVM approach is beating everyone else. And I think for these times here, they're also including the compilation time as well. Actually, that may or may not be true, right? Because compilation should be roughly around 20, 30 milliseconds. So I think this might just be just for execution. All right, so again, so this is showing that with LLVM plus the push-based model, you outperform everyone else. I think the C++ version is also doing the push-based model as well. So it's not clear how much benefit is the push-based model versus the LLVM stuff. All right, so then this graph here is actually a combination of the Haiku paper and the Hyper paper. So it's not a true apples-to-apples comparison because this is running on, you know, clearly running on different hardware, but it's essentially the same TPCH queries. So this is just to give you a rough idea of what the difference you can have compiling things with LLVM versus GCC. All right, so this is running with O2 for Haiku, and you can see for the LLVM, you're in the tens of milliseconds to do compilation with these queries, which is now getting a bit more reasonable. Right? For OLTP, this is still bad because for OLTP, you want to return your queries in milliseconds, like sub or even sub-milliseconds, like microseconds. But for an OLAP query that may run for 500 milliseconds, you know, paying a 30 millisecond overhead to compile it is not that big of a problem. So I will say, though, that when you start doing more complicated queries, and actually when you start doing compilation on what are called machine generated queries. So think of like, say you have like a dashboard or some kind of tool you can use to look at data. And there's all these little check boxes. You can select different options to do your scans, things like that, right? And then that will then, the application will then generate a query that then runs on your database system. So for those kind of dashboards and those kind of things, the queries can end up being quite big. Like, I've heard Google tell me sometimes they have queries that are like just the SQL itself is 10 megabytes, right? So when you have these kind of queries and you run it through even LLVM, even though it's faster than GCC, now you're talking like a second compilation, right? So there is a way to solve it. The Hyper guys have solved it, but they've solved it a year ago and they haven't even written the paper about it. So I don't want to say on camera what it is, because actually, when they told me, I was like, oh yeah, that's actually really clever. That's the right way to do it. So I'll tell you after, if you want to know, I'll tell you afterwards off camera, because they're working on the paper and I don't want the people to see the video and get scooped on this. But they had this problem again when Hyper got bought by Tableau, and they started hooking it up to like, you know, real Postgres tools to see people how, you know, because it's meant to be Postgres compatible. And when you use things like pgAdmin, the first thing pgAdmin is does a bunch of queries and joins in the catalog to see what's in your database. And they would find that because they have to compile all these queries when the system starts up, pgAdmin would stall for like a couple seconds and then actually, you know, turn on. Whereas in the real Postgres, it would come up right away because it didn't have to do all this compilation stuff. So again, they solved that by doing something, which I'll talk about afterwards. All right, so as I said before, we're actually very interested in compilation in our own system. So this is a little micro benchmark that my PhD student Prashant worked on last year that compares the current version of Peloton, which does the interpretation, versus the new LLVM engine that we're hoping to put into the real system this week for some basic TPCH queries. And again, you just get an idea of how much slower our current system was compared to what he can do, right? For some of these basic TPCH queries, he's going from 88 seconds to 900 milliseconds, right? Same database, same query, it's just so much faster. And I think this actually includes also the compilation time as well. I will say though, actually, we can get even faster. So this is actually the unoptimized, this is sort of the first incarnation of his LLM engine. We have the newer version that he's going to hopefully push out for us soon. We'll have, you can cut this down to like by another factor 3x. And the way he's going to get that speed up is what we're going to talk about on Thursday, doing vectorization and prefetching as well. Right? So these things aren't mutually exclusive. You can do compilation plus vectorization plus the push-based stuff we talked about. You can sort of combine all these things together and you can cut this down even further. All right, so in the remaining time, I actually want to talk about now how do real-world systems actually do this. So I'll start off talking about IBM in the beginning, and then I'll go through each of these. The one that I think is actually very different than what most people do is VectorWise, or what's called Active Vector. And then MemSQL actually does what Hyper does, at least the newer version. So I'll talk about what they did before, and I'll talk about what they did afterwards. So, as in all things in database systems, a lot of these ideas aren't new. So this code generation stuff, this query compilation stuff, it actually was in the first database system, right? The IBM guys actually implemented the exact same things that we're talking about here today in the 1970s. Remember, the project started because they got like seven or eight people that all had PhDs. They put them in the same room. They all divided up and worked on different parts. One person worked on code optimization or query optimization. One person worked on SQL. So one person worked on code generation. And so what they would do was they would take a query plan in, and then they would then convert it into the actual assembly code by sort of splicing together different code templates for each operator. And then they would invoke that assembly rather than interpreting the query plan, and it would run much faster than the interpreted version. The reason why this turned out to be bad for them, and they talk about this when there's a bunch of papers, so this is one of them called the History and Evaluation of System R. There's another sort of like, there was a retrospective or a reunion of some of the System R engineers, and they talk about all the different problems and issues that they had trying to build the system in the very first database system. And in these transcripts, they talk about how this seemed like a really awesome idea. It seemed like a no-brainer that you would want to do. But the problem was in the 1970s, it was before sort of x86 became the sort of the standard ISA, right? There's all these different hardware manufacturers. They all had their different chips and they all had their different assembly code. Even IBM had different different models of their systems. They would all have completely different assembly. And so it was really hard to like then, you know, it was impossible from an engineering standpoint to be able to have this run on anything, because for every single new system you wanted to port it to, you had to rewrite all the code generation stuff to support the new assembly. The other big problem that they had was anytime that you change the one aspect of the system, how they laid things out in memory, you then had to go back and rewrite or change all your code generation stuff. So if someone changed the storage manager and says like, all right, now the header for every tuple has these number of slots or this metadata, you then got to go back and change this in the compiler side of things, right? And so that every time this happened, it was a lot of work to go back over and over again and change all these things. This is actually the same problem that MemSQL hit, which I'll talk about in a second, which led them to switch over to do the LLVM, right? So as I said, like this was seemed like a really good idea, but because of all these issues, IBM abandoned this approach. Right? So when they never commercialized System R. The first relational database system they came out with was DB2. The System R people tell me that about 50% of the original DB2 code came from System R. Alright, they brought in some of the SQL stuff and other things, but the things that they didn't even bother to port at all was this piece here, right? The code generation stuff. And up until maybe the last decade or so, or last 15 years, nobody really actually did this, right? Because everyone always looked at the problems that IBM had and they said, well, this is not something we're going to worry about. And also too, they weren't operating on in-memory databases or databases that could fit mostly in memory. If your disk is always your main bottleneck, you're not worried about making function calls as you evaluate tuples. So again, this was originally in the 1970s, but now it's actually in vogue today because the hardware has caught up where we can actually, this is actually something that makes a big difference. In the case of Oracle, as far as I know, at least what I can tell when I look at the documentation, is that they don't do any code generation or query compilation for any aspect of the system. So not even like the for the predicates, which is sort of like the first thing that everyone always does. As far as I can tell, the only thing that they can support is they can take your stored procedures written in PL SQL, and they can convert this into their own dialect of C called ProStar C or ProC. And then from them, they can then compile that into native C or C++ code, which they'll then evoke when you invoke the stored procedure. Right? But still, all the query processing is done with as the interpretive model. Now, in the more expensive versions of Oracle, like Oracle Exadata, they do some early filtering where they can push predicates from sort of the execution rack, the head nodes. They can push it to the storage node and filter tuples directly where the disks are stored, so they don't ship them back over the wire. For that one, I think they do compilation. But if you go download regular Oracle and run on a single box, it doesn't do this. One thing that Oracle is doing that is different from anybody else is that they're not even bothering with the code generation or the code specialization by generating software on the fly to execute things efficiently. They're skipping that entirely, and they're actually putting SQL functionality directly in the hardware. So this came out probably 2 years ago. So when you buy the newer Spark chips from Oracle, right, remember, Oracle bought Sun, and Sun was making the Spark Niagara chips. In the newer versions of the Spark chips, they actually have explicit instructions to do database stuff, right? So they have instructions to do memory scans. They can do dictionary compression and decompression, vectorized instructions and other things. So they're actually not even doing code specialization at the software level. They're doing code specialization at the hardware level. And this is going to be way faster than anything LLVM could do because it's all baked into hardware. So this is sort of a smart move from Oracle's standpoint, I think from a business side, because if people are on Amazon, they're using RDS, if they're using sort of this cloud infrastructure, they may be more amenable to switching from Oracle to an open source or cheaper system. But now if you say, look, you have your Oracle box, you really want to get good performance, they'll lock you into specialized hardware that you're not going to be able to get on Amazon or Azure. So I think that's sort of interesting. We'll see how this plays out. I will say also, too, this idea is not new either. Putting database functionality on hardware was in vogue in the 1980s when these database machines, these specialized appliances came out. And that sort of went away because commodity hardware became cheaper and better. we might talk about this later in the semester, but like there is sort of this, seems to be a trend now to add back specialized hardware and databases, or for databases to speed these things up. All right, for Hackathon, I talked about this a little bit from the beginning. So Hackathon can compile both the stored procedures and the SQL statements itself. And one of the interesting things that they do is because, again, Hackathon was designed to be this engine that was meant to work with the, you know, the entire SQL Server ecosystem. If you're going to have, you know, Hackathon transactions have to touch tables that are in the non-Hackathon portion of the system, you don't want that to go through the interpreter engine because it'd be really, really slow. So what they could also do was they could generate C code for queries that have to touch tables that aren't in Hackathon. They can then invoke directly the low-level storage managers of the regular side of SQL Server and have that run really fast without doing interpretation, right? So it's sort of the same thing as in Haiku, like you're generating the C code, and then you compile this into using Visual Studio Compiler that you then link into the runtime, and then you can invoke and get whatever data you need. So obviously, this is dangerous, and Microsoft cares about security a lot, so they have a bunch of additional mechanisms in place to prevent you from writing SQL query that could then, you know, take over the SQL Server box, right? So it's not just you can just write raw C and do all these things. They have a bunch of checks to make sure that you don't, you know, you don't do buffer overruns and all the problems that Windows used to have in the early versions of the operating system. You want to avoid that in your database system. With Impala, Cloudera Impala is another, it's one of the other few systems that actually uses the LLVM. But unlike in the case of with Hyper, where they compile the entire query plan using LLVM, as far as I know, in Impala, they only do compilation for just evaluating the predicates, so avoiding how to, you know, go down the tree, but then also for record parsing. So this part, record parsing is actually different. We haven't really talked about this at all for the other systems because Impala was meant to run in the Hadoop ecosystem, so they want to read files off of HDFS. And so the idea is that they can support all these different formats for all these different serialization methods or protocols, you know, whether it's protocol buffers or Thrift files or Parquet or just HDFS files. So they want to speed up parsing those files and then read them into Impala real quickly. And so if you know the schema of those files, then you can bake an LLVM program that knows how to jump to different offsets to find the data you're looking for and then produce it into the format you need to read into memory that you can then execute the Impala queries directly on. So again, I won't say too much about Impala now. Marcel is the lead developer of Impala from Cloudera. He'll be speaking at the end of the semester. So he'll talk about a little, I've told him to talk a little bit more about this LLVM stuff they're doing as well, right? Because we haven't really talked about the shared nothing aspect. We haven't talked about distributed databases. We're really focusing on how you actually make things run fast on a single node. And so this is the stuff that I think is relevant to what we're talking about here. All right, so Actium Vector, formerly VectorWise, formerly MonaDB X100, is, in my opinion, actually was another one of the most state-of-the-art database systems that were out there. It was an in-memory system that could do really fast execution of queries because it would do the sort of vectorized processing. Right? Instead of calling get next to get single tuples, they would call get next and produce a vector tuples, which they could then do SIMD and other vectorized instructions on really, really quickly. So what's interesting about Vector, or VectorWise, and actually it's really sad, when you look at the website for Actian, right, if you go Google Actian Vector or VectorWise, it takes you to the Actian homepage, and they're trying to pretend like the product doesn't exist anymore. They basically let go the entire VectorWise team, which was a huge mistake. Well, I'm on video, but whatever. And all those guys, all those awesome people that built VectorWise, some of them went to Snowflake DB, but some of them went to Databricks to work on Spark. And it sucks because I think this system is awesome. Like, Dana's done some experiments with it, and it outperforms pretty much anything else. It's sort of neck to neck with Hyper, and this is sort of, you know, for our new system that Prashant's been working on, we can get pretty close to VectorWise. But in my opinion, what they were doing was actually really interesting. So VectorWise, I think I said this in the beginning, they don't do on-the-fly code generation or query compilation, meaning when the query plan comes in, they don't generate the C++ code or the LLVM IR. What they instead are going to do is they're going to have these bunch of these different primitives that perform some small task that you would have to do inside of a query. Like, scan a column and evaluate a predicate where all the columns are integers and the predicate you're evaluating has a boolean in it or a double in it. So it's going to generate all these different primitives, and they say that in the paper, they say there's about 5,000 of them. And then when a query plan comes in, they're basically going to stitch together these different primitives to produce the query plan, and they just sort of run that and let it go. And so in this case here, you're still going to have function calls, which we said were bad, but because they're doing vectorized execution, they're not doing a function call per tuple as you would in the volcano model. They're doing it for every 1,000 tuples or 10,000 tuples. So the overhead of calling these functions is sort of amortized across the doing these things in batches. So give an idea what this primitive looks like. So this is doing a scan on a column. And for both of these, you want to evaluate the same predicate, where the attribute at a particular column is less than some value. And so the two things I'm showing out here is, one, they're both doing the less than operator. So this is baked into the actual function call. But then we're passing in different types of arguments. And so the compiler knows that, all right, if it's an int32, it's 32 bits. The double will be 64 bits. So it knows how to align all this and you know, generate efficient machine code. And then at runtime, we just pass in these pointers and invoke this. So the query optimizer or the compiler would say, all right, well, I know I'm doing this query plan, and it's going to do a less than operator on this column. And the column is 32-bit integers, and it's a double in my predicate. So I know I want to invoke this function. All right, so now I don't have any conditional branches other than the thing we talked about here, which we'll talk about on Thursday. But I don't have to do any lookups to say, is it a double, is it an int, what is it? And I know how to jump exactly to the offsets that I need. So again, they compile all these ahead of time, and they put it all together. So this is why I think in the results that I showed, the vector-wise was doing pretty close to what Hyper can do. Because essentially, it wasn't doing code compilation as we're describing here, but it, at the high level, it more or less is doing the same thing. Right? Because everything is sort of pre-generated. All right, so with MemSQL, in the first incarnation of MemSQL, up until about last year, they would do the haiku style code generation they would generate some C code, and then they would fork GCC, and then link in that shared object. So this, again, as I shared before, GCC is really slow, and they knew this for, when they would do their experiments or have people show people the system. And so the way they would avoid having to invoke GCC every time is that they would take any query that would come in, and they would convert it into a parameterized form, and then cache the shared object that you generate from GCC, so that the next time you execute the same query, you can just use the cache shared object. So let's say I have a query like this, select star from A, where A ID equals 123. Right, so this is baked in as a constant, 123. So if I generate C code that had this 123 baked in it, any other query that came along that used a different value here couldn't use the same plan. So they would just do basic, they would extract out the constants, replace them with input variables, input parameters, like a prepared statement, and then cache that shared object. So then when the next query came in, the same syntax except for its AID equals 456, they would know that they could reuse this and not have to invoke GCC again. So their approach to this was basically just doing naive string matching. So they would always extract the constant and just see whether there was an exact string match in their cache plan. So that means that say if I have like a.id equals something and b.id equals something, if I had another query that came in later that was just flip the order of those things, it was b.id equals something and then aid equals something, their string matcher wouldn't be able to find it, right? Obviously, the way to fix this is you can look at the syntax tree and avoid these issues. But in their version that they had prior to last year, it didn't actually do this. And in the old documentation, if you read some of the old blog posts about MemSQL, they would give examples where they would, to address the slowness of GCC, they would show this example where you would invoke the first query and the runtime would take 1 second, then you invoke the same query again and the runtime would go to zero. And then that's how they would show that, yes, GCC is slow, but we can cache these things and be smart about it. So when I first met the MemSQL guys in 2013, I knew about them for a while, but then I went to go visit them in 2013 before I started at CMU. They sort of confessed to me that they'd been around for a while, if they were going to do MemSQL all over again, they actually would have not done the code generation stuff that I showed before at the very beginning. Because they were having the exact same problems that the IBM guys did, was anytime you change anything, any layout in the system or any organization of the system, you'd have to go change the code generation part of the system. And that became very brittle. Right? Any minor change would break everything else. And it became really hard for them to add new operators and expand the functionality over time. And then in 2015, they started working on the new version of the system, which then came out in 2016. Where they hired the guy that did the hip hop VM at Facebook. Right? Hip hop VM was like Facebook's optimized version of the PHP runtime. This guy, Drew Porosky, and they had him rewrite the entire code generation portion of the system to now use LLVM. And what they do is actually kind of interesting. So in the case of the Hyper paper you guys read, they have a bunch of macros, a bunch of macros to generate the LLVM IR together, then stitch together a query. But the problem with Hyper, and we're sort of going to face this problem in our own system, is finding people that actually can write LLVM code is actually really hard. Right? It's hard enough to find people that can write C++ code inside a database system, but now you got to find people that can write LLVM code in a database system. And in the case of Hyper, it was pretty much written by like two dudes, right? And not every student, not every person that worked on it was able to modify the LLVM stuff. And so the MemSQL guys saw this was going to be a problem too in their system. And what they decided to do is they would have sort of multiple stages of starting with a high level language that you'd use to generate your query plan, and then get to lower and lower representations till you finally got down to the LLVM IR. So they had this thing called the MemSQL programming language, which more or less looks like a dialect of C++. And if you read this link, if you click this link here when I post the slides, it'll take you to a high scalability blog from this guy, and he'll show you what this thing looks like. But the idea is here is that you have a query plan that can then be converted into this C++ DSL, and then you can take that and then compile that using LLVM into what they call the MemSQL bytecode, which basically looks a lot like the JVM bytecode. If you know how SQLite works, SQLite has sort of these opcodes as well. The same basic idea. And then you can take that bytecode and then compile it again in LLVM to generate the IR, which then produces the native code. So the reason why they do this is because, again, not everyone is going to be able to write at this lower level here, but most people, you think anybody you're hiring to work in your database system should be able to write C++. So they can all work on this. And then you just have a few smart people write this part to actually do the conversion. So you can modify all of this without changing any of this part here. The another aspect that is not really addressed in the Hyper paper, but it actually is a big deal with LLVM, is that it's actually very hard to debug. Because if you crash, if you get a seg fault, you're not going to get like a line number to say where it actually failed. Instead, you're going to get a bunch of assembly that the LLVM generated for you. And it's really hard to say, well, where was that assembly actually came from? In this case here, you can compile this and run this and debug this and see whether it actually works. And knowing that this stuff is solid, you can make changes and debug this without worrying about this part down here. So again, your regular developers can open up GCC and see whether the high-level stuff actually works without worrying about looking at assembly stack traces and things like that. So I actually think this is sort of from a software engineering standpoint, I think this is the better way to do it than what the Hyper guys do. But you need to hire the dude that wrote the hip hop VM to make this happen, right? This is a lot of software engineering work that doesn't actually help the core functionality of the system, but actually just makes it easier to maintain. And so this, as far as I know, MemSQL's the only one that does this. All right, and the last one I'm gonna talk about is VitiseDB. To be very clear, I think this is either Vitisa or VitiseDB. There's also Vitise without the E at the end, which is another database startup that does optimization for MySQL. These are the Postgres GreenPlum guys. So what they actually do is they have a sort of custom query accelerator that they wrote in LLVM that does all the things that we talked about before. You can do the predicate evaluation. They're doing a push-based model, like in Hyper. And they try to inline everything, and they can leverage the hardware to do overflow detection. Actually, this is another big thing that I forgot to mention. In that, when you evaluate that predicate tree, at every single step, you have to do all these extra checks, like, is the thing null? Did I overflow my integers, right? We talked about this before when we saw the difference between the numerics and the floating point numbers and the fixed point numbers, right? There's all that extra checks that you have to do, but which makes it slower. So when you evaluate predicates, using the interpretive model, it's all those extra checks are actually slowing you down too. But the hardware can do some of this for you, and the LLVM can help you with this. So the way Vatice works is that they use the execution hooks or callback methods inside of Postgres, so that when a query plan comes in, it goes through the normal query Postgres query optimizer, and then if it's a select statement, then they intercept it and then shove it off to their LLVM engine that knows how to read and write directly on the Postgres data files, but it has a completely brand new execution engine. And they can do this, they can do query parallelism that the way the Postgres can do, and they get much, much better performance. Anytime you have to do any modification, insert, update, delete, or anytime that you make a change to the database schema, like updating the catalog, then it goes to the regular Postgres stuff. So again, and this link here is at a Postgres conference probably, I think, 2 years ago. And one of the founders of this company, they sort of go through and talk about all the things they had to do to make Vatice be 100x faster than stock Postgres. They're also using a column store. They're also doing some other things that aren't relevant here, but it's a lot of the same techniques that we already talked about. All right, so what are my parting thoughts? So I think query compilation is very important. It makes a huge difference, as we saw in these numbers here. You'll see a bigger difference in performance for OLAP instead of OLTP. Right, OLTP, again, you're doing index lookups to go grab small number tuples. So the LLVM doesn't really help you there. It's really for the OLAP stuff when you have to access a lot of data. Then reducing the number of instructions makes a big difference. In my opinion, I think that the 2016 version of MemSQL, the LLVM stuff that I talked about with the intermediate language, the DSL, I consider that actually the best compilation engine that's out there. I think also Hyper is actually very good too as well, but it's difficult to work on. And Hackathon is very good as well. It does some other smart things. And then VectorWise is interesting too, but again, it might be dead at this point. So it is my opinion that any new database system that wants to do analytics, if you're not doing code generation and query compilation, you're not going to be able to compete with these other systems that do. In the case of Spark, right, in Spark SQL, they have a blog post probably a year or two ago. They have a newer paper, I think, last year. They're now doing code compilation or query generation. This is the trend. This is the major trend in database systems that's going on now, and this is what everyone is doing. And it's kind of weird to think about because it's a lot different than what we teach you as an undergrad or in the intro course about this interpretation model. You sort of have to rethink how you're actually going to architect the system to take advantage of this. Okay? So any questions about code generation or query compilation? Yes?
Sort of a tangential question. Why is it a custom in database papers not to name commercial systems?
His question is, why is it a custom to, in database papers, to not name the actual name of the system? If you have to go, but if you want to learn about to answer his question, I will tell you. So in the paper you guys read, it was called DBX. And this is because of what is called a DeWitt clause. So David DeWitt was a very famous, is a very famous database professor. He used to be at Wisconsin. He started a new research lab for Microsoft called the Jim Gray Lab in Madison. And then as of last fall, he left Madison, and now he's at MIT with Mike Sternbricker. So he's a longtime friend of Mike Sternbricker, so they're both at MIT together. So this is his Wikipedia page. I know this because he made me update this last week because he didn't want to change it himself. So to his question here, the thing that he was referring to, the reason why you have to not name a system is what's called the DeWitt clause. And it's named after this database professor. So the story goes, when David DeWitt was an early database professor at Wisconsin, he made this system called Exodus. And he benchmarked him. He benchmarked Exodus. It was a relational database system. He benchmarked against the two major relational databases that are at the time: Ingress, which was his friend Mike Snowbaker, and Oracle, right, from Larry Ellison. So in his paper that came out, his system destroyed the other systems, right? And so he published it and said, look how much faster my system is than Oracle and Ingress. Stonebreaker was pissed, but Stonebreaker called, the way Stonebreaker got back at him, he called him at the middle of the night and said, how can you do this, right? How could you betray me, right? Larry Ellison, he went to the president of the university, the chancellor, and demanded that the University of Wisconsin fire David DeWitt because they maligned his database system, right? Then he went to the department chair at Wisconsin and said, you have to fire David DeWitt. And sort of like, and obviously the university is like, no, we're a university, we're not doing this, right? So by personal decree of Larry Ellison, the Oracle Corporation would not hire anybody from the University of Wisconsin system for one decade, for 10 years, right? And then they went back and changed the user license agreements in their for all the Oracle database systems so that you could not name the Oracle Corporation by name or the Oracle system by name in any academic study that was not sanctioned by Oracle. So that's why you see this DBX and all these different papers. Now, as far as I know, a bunch of other systems also have the same license agreement, but in general, people just avoid that because they want to avoid the same mess that DeWitt was into. Which now, flash forward to 2009, DeWitt and Stonebreaker and I worked on a paper. We compared like Hadoop and MapReduce against Vertica and another commercial database system. Vertica was DeWitt's and Stonebreaker's startup, so obviously they were able to beat Hadoop without any problems. Hadoop wasn't very good, still isn't very good, but Vertica crushed it. But then this commercial database system, the parallel version, I was able to get Hadoop to beat that. And so then we showed this company. We said, hey, look, our grad student, running Hadoop is able to beat your, million-dollar database system. What do you think about that? So, same thing. They start freaking out, and they threaten to make a DeWitt clause on their database system, right? So in exchange for us replacing it from the real name of the system, which I can tell you offline, and calling it DBMSX, they had a DBA come and fix the system for us to make it run faster. So it got a little bit faster than Hadoop, but not by much. Right, because it would look bad if, like, here's this, like, Hadoop thing. This is like early, it's like 2008. Hadoop was able to beat this, million-dollar system by just doing some simple things. So this is what's known as a DeWitt clause, right? And there's a couple articles here in these links in the Wikipedia page that describe like more about this. A bunch of different systems that have it. So I would say it's sort of like a chilling effect, like. Not all systems have DeWitt clauses, but like people just avoid that because you don't want to have piss people off. Okay? More than you know. All right, any questions? All right, so Thursday we'll talk about vectorization, and then I'll send an email out about doing a rebase for your code for the latest changes we have in the system. Okay? All right, guys, thanks. See you on Thursday.